Hi. Patients with epilepsy often complain about memory loss, forgetfulness, not able to find words, and lots of processing and issues with their memory. So what can cause memory loss? Well, today we'll talk in details how memory can be disturbed and how to fix it in people with epilepsy. And as an epilepsy specialized neurologist, my patients always ask me, doctor, am I having Alzheimer's disease? Am I losing my memory? How can I help my memory to get better? And today we'll answer all of these questions and more. There are multiple causes of memory loss. And for us to understand memory loss, let's first have a word on how the memory forms and what is the relation of epilepsy in all those details. Well, we used to think that memory and language is only one area, has one function, but now with a better understanding of the neuroscience of cognitive function, we understand that memory and language is a process of multiple areas and networks in the brain that process and facilitate information and store it in the future. In order for you to have a good memory function, you first need to do a storing and understanding of the information. So the first you need to have a good attention and process the information that are being told to you. For example, if you are being given three words and three tasks to remember and do, and if you did not have enough attention to focus on all of those three tasks, you might remember one and two and then forget the others and then say like, oh, my memory is not good. But the problem is not being able to focus and have attention. And then the second function is storing the information. When storing information, we put the information in an area of the brain that can be retrieved and brought back later for later use. And if you have memory loss, it seems like you're holding a handful of sand and the sand keeps slipping between your fingers and you're not able to hold on information for a long time. And this is responsibility of the hippocampus deep inside the temporal lobe, which holds information and then store it in other areas of the brain. And the third function to get the memory back is retrieval. So retrieval, which is bringing the memory back, and usually any memory that we add to the brain and remember, we always associate it with other things that we know and learned before, so that will be easy access and we can bring it back. So sometimes there is an issue with retrieval. So we cannot associate memories correctly and we could not remember. For example, if you go to a restaurant and then I ask you later, oh, do you remember how was the restaurant day? And then you say like, oh, which restaurant? I don't remember anything. And then I tell you, oh, remember that Italian restaurant with the waitress kept putting us extra Parmesan on the pasta? It's like, oh, that Italian restaurant. Yes, we had a good fun. And I remember I ordering pasta and it was amazing and we had a good time. So you remember that. If I give you the tracing and the information bits and pieces, you can put them together and remember. But sometimes you have a hard time accessing those memories that were already stored. And epilepsy itself can disturb this function of remembering and retrieval, and especially affects the part of memory responsible for facts and words, and which is called semantic memory or verbal memory. Interesting recent studies showed that in people with epilepsy, when they're trying to remember a new thing and there is an epileptic activity sparks during the learning process, there will not be a good remembering of that piece of information and they will not be able to remember. And we even now trying to study ways to stimulate the brain to strengthen the memory and the remembering of the certain activities. Let me know down in the comments if you have any memory issues with epilepsy and what are you doing to handle that. So seizures can cause major disturbance in all the systems of memory, especially in the temporal lobe and hippocampus. And we know that large amount of seizures happen in the temporal lobe. And it's no wonder that you might be having a large seizure that's shaking all over and you fall to the ground and then you wake up not remembering anything. It's like, oh, you had a seizure. It's like, what seizure? And you do not remember. We had experienced that so many times in the video EEG monitoring. The patients would be in the unit. We see the seizure. We ask them, did you have a seizure? And they will say no. And this happens because the area of the memory encoding, the area we write memories, is the one it is involved during the seizure. So there will be no writing and no encoding of any memories. And if the seizures happen a lot, back and forth, lots of seizures, and the seizures are long, it can affect the memory areas and the hippocampus and cause damage to that area and region of the brain. And that is called causes hardening, and it's called temporal sclerosis or mesial temporal sclerosis or hippocampus hippocampal sclerosis, and those all can cause major disturbance in memory function in people with epilepsy and seizures. And because the hippocampus is essential in remembering and sorting all the information, imagine the one that is responsible for sorting all of your shipments in the warehouse is not working that day. So all the shipments will come in and you cannot sort them. So there is no good system to retrieve the information, and then good luck finding that pair of shoes. And the second function of the brain is the language areas. And it is important to understand that language areas are in multiple areas of the brain, mostly on the left side in the dominant hemisphere. And what happens is that the language gets understood in the top of the temporal lobe, called Wernicke's area. It processes the information, understand the question, understand the information, and then it will process it and send it to the speaking area, which is called Broca's area. And that is responsible for forming of the speech and then talking it out. And those areas also can get disturbed and not communicating together because of seizure activity or electricity problems in the brain. And then you have issues with language and talking and speaking. And especially in kids, it happens a lot. They can have language problems. And then sometimes they're like, oh, the word is at the tip of my tongue, but I cannot talk it out. And the last thing is the executive function. Executive function is the planning, and usually happens in the frontal lobe, and the frontal lobe is also commonly affected by seizures. So you plan your day, you plan your activities, and plan 1, 2, 3. Also, it's your breaks and social appropriateness. So in the frontal lobe, it tells you if things are appropriate to do or not. Like, for example, if you want to take the chocolate from that kid, then the frontal lobe will tell you, no, you cannot do that. It's inappropriate. So those are all functions of the frontal lobe. And then if you have issues with epilepsy, you can have issues with planning, issues with focusing on multiple tasks, and so on. All right, what are the possible causes of memory loss in epilepsy? There are multiple. The first one is the age and how long the seizures have been going on. The longer the seizures have been going on, the more likely that the memory will be affected. And the second reason is the cause of epilepsy. Sometimes the epilepsy is caused by a stroke or by a traumatic brain injury that affects the memory areas. Also, the presence of seizure activity can worsen that. And sometimes we have a genetic cause of epilepsy that disturbs the build of the brain and as a consequence also cause memory issues. And the third cause is the presence of psychiatric comorbidities. Means that if you have anxiety, depression, PTSD, all of those can disturb the memory function and block memories because it does not want to deal with them a lot, because some of them are painful memories and end up also disturbing normal memories. And the last is anti-seizure medication side effects. We have to have a word about anti-seizure medications. There are multiple anti-seizure medications that, because they inhibit the brain and decrease the electricity, also will decrease normal functions of the brain. And one of the most medications that can cause memory issues are phenobarbital, notorious for memory issues, benzodiazepines such as clobazam and clonazepam, also medications like zonisamide, and the most notorious medication of all is Topamax. So Topamax causes slowing in the memory processing, word finding difficulty, you cannot say the words correctly, and overall lots of cognitive processing issues, to the point that we doctors call it Dopamax because of the all of those cognitive issues. All right, how can we test for memory functions in people with epilepsy? The first thing is bring that to your doctor's attention. So we always focus on seizure control and medication side effects during the visit, but I want you to next time talk to your doctor about memory loss in epilepsy and what can be done about that. And the second thing is that we can do lab work, because sometimes there are deficiencies in vitamins such as vitamin B12 and thyroid dysfunction. All of those can affect the memory function and those can be easily corrected. And the last thing is doing an EEG of the brain, and this will give us a good evaluation of a brain waves that sometimes are excessive and lots of them happening, and that can disturb the memory. And it is important to do an EEG during sleep as well, because in the sleep there is consolidation of memories, and if there is lots of epilepsy activity during sleep, that will disturb the memory function. Also, we can do a brain MRI to look at the structure of the brain if there is anything can explain memory loss. And it is important to screen for any comorbid psychiatric conditions such as depression, anxiety, or PTSD, because all of those can block the memories, and treating them will help memory as well. And then comes the actual memory test. We can test the memory in the office with your doctor easily by using some of the screening tools, and one of the best tools we do is Montreal Cognitive Assessment, MOCA. And this test is very quickly administered in about 5 minutes, and any healthcare provider can administer the test. And it tests so many different language and memory functions and gives us a good estimation and idea of any areas of the brain that is disturbed and memory is affected. And sometimes if we want to have a deeper understanding of memory function, we often send the patients to a comprehensive neuropsychological evaluation, which is a detailed memory test of all different aspects of memory, and that will give us good ideas about all the areas of the brain and how the functions are. And usually this test takes anywhere from 4 to 8 hours, and best if it is done by somebody who is a PhD neuropsychologist that is specialized in epilepsy and neuropsychology. And then we have more advanced testing that we can do to localize where the language and memory areas are, such as MEG, magnetoencephalogram, functional MRI, and even invasive tests such as the Wada test that we reserve for patients who are being prepared for epilepsy surgery to make sure that we do not affect any areas of memory and language when we do the surgery. All right, now the best part. Let's talk about how we can treat memory dysfunction and forgetfulness in epilepsy. All right, the treatment is always tailored to the cause of epilepsy and how we understand the memory dysfunction. So number one, if there is a lot of seizures and the brain has lots of discharges in EEG, then it makes sense to increase the anti-seizure medications and get good control of your seizures, because it is essential to control the seizures because they often disturb the memory function. And the second thing is assessment of anti-seizure medications. So we look at all the medication that you are taking, and then if you are taking some of the medication that are notorious for causing memory problems, such as Topamax, we might be needing to decrease the dose of the medication or switch you to a different medication that does not have medication and cognitive issues. And number three is treating any underlying psychiatric conditions, such as anxiety, depression, PTSD. All of those can affect your memory by blocking the memories. And if you treat them, then usually memory will improve as well. And then the fourth thing is memory training and cognitive rehabilitation. We have a program that can be done to train the memory and give you tricks and clues how we can process information quicker and have strategies to process the information and remembering your day. And this can be done either through speech pathology or neuropsychology. And all of those are important tactics that you can use, such as journaling every day and keeping your list of shopping lists and other things that you need to do, have a routine of activities, setting alarms on your phone. All of those can help your memory to strengthen and have a routine for your brain to process easily. And the fifth thing is to have a healthy memory, we need a healthy body. So it is important to exercise, have good amount of sleep for 8 hours for adults, and also to have a balanced diet and to control any other medical conditions such as diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and cholesterol. All of those, if you control them well, you have a good environment for the brain to function better and heal itself and cause a good amount of cognitive function. And it is important to learn about anti-seizure medications and how they work and what are their side effects, so that you can even discuss with your doctor how you can be treated better. And to do just that, you need to see this video about all the anti-seizure medications and have an excellent understanding. And stay healthy, and see you in the next one. Salam.